Hey, everybody. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today, we have an interview with Rhett Reese and Paul Wernick, writers of the hit Netflix movie Spiderhead.
At Spiderhead, we're proud of our work.
Your presence in this facility, while technically a punishment, is a privilege.
Where have you been?
Drug study.
In science, we have to explore the unknown.
They've been testing me up and down. A lot weirder stuff than usual.
This is new frontier stuff here.
Before we begin, I need your permission to administer Dan 40.
This place can really mess with your head.
I chatted with the writing duo about their approach to adapting George Saunders' short story, how they balance the different tones in the film, their collaborative process, and more. Check it out. Rhett and Paul, thank you for taking the time to chat with me today. Welcome to the podcast. Spiderhead, how would you describe it's the number one movie on Netflix right now, so a lot of people have probably seen it, but how would you describe it to the folks who haven't?
It's near sci-fi, so near future sci-fi that touches on themes about private prisons and pharmacology. It's about kind of evil billionaire type who is experimenting on inmates with emotion-altering drugs. And it's got a lot in it. It's a mashup of tones. It's both a dark comedy, and it's a little bit of a satire, and it's a little bit of a thriller, and it's a sci-fi movie, and it's a drama, and it's a love story. So it's hard to qualify or quantify.
All based on a short story by George Saunders, the brilliant George Saunders, who is, I think, the preeminent short story author of our time and maybe of all time. So
to that point, did you read what was your first encounter with the short story? Was it something you just read and were like, hey, this would make a great movie? Was it something that came to you, you know, as a potential possibility? How did you, you know, what was your way into this?
Condé Nast, which owns The New Yorker, has a film and TV division. Jeremy Steckler was the executive at the time. He put it in front of us when it first was printed in The New Yorker about 10 years ago. We fell in love with it. We said, we're doing it. We have to write this. We were so passionate about it. We wrote it on spec, which means we wrote it for free with the intention to direct. And it felt like the perfect first thing for us to, you know, wet our feet with, a very self-contained, you know, mostly on stage claustrophobic, you know, drama. And so it took us about 2.5-3 months to write. We, you know, George had laid out, you know, what was the makings of a movie, but we had to expand it out. It wasn't the traditional three-act structure. His short story didn't fall into the traditional three-act structure of a movie. So, you know, we basically, you know, took all of what George Saunders brought to it and then, you know, added, you know, a love story and you know, themes of love conquering all and such. And we wrote it quickly. And then, you know, we got busy with Deadpool. Our lives changed, you know, almost, you know, at the snap of a finger. And so we had to withdraw from directing. And Joe Kaczynski came aboard. We sold it to Netflix. Chris Hemsworth read the script. He fell in love with it. And, you know, from about 2 years ago on, it was kind of off to the races. But up until then, it was a lot of starts and stops and starts and stops with indie financing and such, and actors and trying to get the right pieces together to justify a film.
Rhett, so Paul just mentioned, you know, that, it, you know, this is a contained location sort of thing. You know, you guys have written a lot of movies. Life is another one that's kind of a contained location. But then you write Deadpool and Six Underground. Does your guys' approach for when you're, you know, talking about those, you know, different types of projects, or is it the same sort of head-on approach?
Well, I mean, I like the claustrophobia angle because I think it puts downward pressure on your characters. I mean, it certainly did when they were in that space station in Life. And here you've got a prison. There are no windows. There's no way out, literally. And the whole movie is about escaping that. What I like about it is it's a little bit of a change for us. We're used to painting on a really broad canvas where we can use the entire globe and all sorts of different locations, maybe even a post-apocalyptic world. We have CG at our hands, at our disposal, and all these various things. We tend to write globe hopping type of movies. We continually are writing for different countries and things like that. And so it was a nice sort of counterweight challenge to do something that would felt a little bit more like a chamber piece or like a play, something like that. But I think we go where the ideas take us. If there's a great claustrophobic idea, we would write it. And if there's a great expansive idea, we would write that.
And you know, it's interesting because the claustrophobia and the contained, you know, space really did play into the COVID of it all, right? It was kind of the perfect COVID movie because it's a small cast. It's all on stage and in a fairly contained circumstance. So it allowed for us to be in production when a lot of people couldn't be in production.
Did you have to change the script at all once you knew you were going to be filming during COVID, or was it something that?
No, not at all. I mean, it's shot in Australia, which was very COVID friendly at the time, or rather unfriendly to the virus, and that they were locked down. And you had to, when you came to Australia, you had to go into quarantine for 14 days in a government approved hotel. You're allowed to leave your room only for an hour a day and to go out to the yard. It was truly like a prison for the people who went. We stayed behind and did everything via Zoom. And I think we were one of the poster children of how to make a movie safely and COVID. They did a great, great job.
So just to go back to George Saunders and the fact that the movie's based on a short story. I mean, talk about a short story. For you guys, what's the adaptation process like in terms of deciding what to keep, what to expand, what to change? You know, how much responsibility do you feel to staying true to the story? Just talk about your approach and how all those things come together for you guys.
Yeah, I mean, we feel a deep responsibility to the original author and to George. Again, he's brilliant. And so our feeling was, you know, it was like Thanksgiving. Like, we wanted to use every part of the turkey we could. You know, George Gate, you know, I think every little bit of that short story is in the movie, you know, including the dialogue. And so we, you know, threw in the gizzards and, you know, and the neck and, you know, made soup out of it, and, you know, leftovers the next afternoon. Like we really did, you know, try and strip that thing bare. So again, when you're given the gifts that George Saunders gave us, you know, you best use them.
I'd love to hear you guys talk a little bit about the tone of the film, or rather the tones. It's, you know, it's scary, it's thrilling, it's funny, it's kind of, you know, nerve-wracking. How does that come out on the page? And then, you know, in terms of your intention and in terms of the thought process behind it, I'm curious, because it's such a tightrope you guys are walking in this movie, where you go from, you know, laughing one minute to extreme violence the next, and you're still kind of laughing. And I'm just curious, you know, for you guys, is it a smell test? Do you just try different versions of things to see what sticks? How does that work for you?
Well, we've always felt that tension and comedy are strange bedfellows, but they really are bedfellows. Like, we have had a lot of movies where there's a lot at stake and real tension, and yet we find that comedy weaves through them really nicely. An audience is very willing to go with you on the journey where they're laughing one minute and horrified the next and then laughing again. It's almost like comic relief in a way. But this is a beautiful mashup of tones that really came out of George's head. And it was our task to sort of write past the author, which I don't recommend to people who are adapting things. We're going to be looking to adapt a full novel next time if we're doing more prose, but because we had to write past what he'd done. And that entailed keeping that tone consistent and not letting an audience feel like at the 45-minute mark of the movie, about halfway through, like they were being handed off to another author. We wanted the voice and the tone and the feeling to stay throughout. And that was our task. Whether we succeeded or not is entirely up to the audience to decide, but we do believe in movies that mash tones. We really do. All of our movies tend to do it.
Paul, you guys have written a couple of movies for Netflix now. Is your approach different when you know it's going to be on streaming versus something you know is going to be playing in a, you know, huge theater with huge crowds?
No, I mean, we you know, always, you know, it's always story, right? I mean, it's never its distribution source. It's just where the story takes us. And again, Six Underground and Spiderhead, two very, very different, you know, scope and scales of movies, both ended up on, you know, a streaming service on Netflix, and they're wonderful partners. And again, like, the only thing that I get bummed out about a little bit when on the streaming side of it is, you know, we watched Spiderhead in a theater you know, for the premiere in New York at the Paris Theater, which Netflix owns, or just recently bought, and it's beautiful, and you've got a big crowd. And the communal experience, that's the only thing I think, you know, that, you know, that you miss, you know, in a streaming service that you get in a theater. But in terms of our process and writing, no, it's a movie. You know, we write it as big and as much as the story will support.
So speaking of process, Rhett, can you guys, and Paul, can you guys talk about, okay, you're going to write Spiderhead. And in this case, you've got some existing source material. From there, how do you guys operate? Do you do extensive outlinings? Do you have lots of stuff up on a big board? Do you do a vomit draft and then, you know, kind of go back and take us from just start to finish what your process is like?
Well, we work on the outline together. We do outline, we use a board. More virtually, we've tended to use kind of virtual boards, but in the old days, we would use a cork board. And then when it comes time to write, we go our separate ways. We divide up the scenes. So every scene is numbered. We kind of look at them and we choose which scenes we want to write. We say, oh, why don't we start with you writing 1 and 2 and 3 and I'll write 4 and 5. And
it's like a fantasy draft, you know,
a little bit.
Your favorites, you know.
Yeah, I think we just each write the scenes that we've kind of already been pre-writing in our head. You're always kind of pre-writing a scene in your head, at least I am. So and then it's final draft takes over. Like we get into the software, not to butter you guys up, but we get into the software and we write the scene individually and then we email it to the other person. And then they make changes within the scene. So we don't give each other notes. We just directly make changes within the scene and we bold the changes and then we send it back. And then generally you'll read the bolds. You'll decide which of the bolds you're okay with. The ones you're okay with, you unbold. The ones you're not okay with, you change to a third version and rebold and send them back. And I think that process, that iterative process is what creates a finished scene. And then we build that out into a movie. We don't really do vomit drafts in the sense that we're trying to have the first draft, once all the scenes are strung together, be very solid. And then of course we do rewrite. And at that point, we generally divide the script in half. So it's like, you'll be working in the front half, I'll be working in the back half, and then we're swapping back and forth just for efficiency's sake. But there's a real process we use, and we've used it for the better part of 20 years, and it's worked, so we don't really mess with it.
A first draft is really probably a 10th draft. The first draft that goes out beyond our eyes has been, you know, combed over, you know, 10 times over, just, you know, and again, it's what I always say about partnerships, which is having a writing partner, other than, you know, the benefit of riding all the waves of Hollywood and having someone to bounce off of emotionally. But one of the great benefits is that it's quality control, right? It's like you lose all perspective when you're writing a script. You don't know if it's good or it's bad. And when that other person, you know, reads it, when your partner reads it, a scene for the first time, you get that quality control. We get that, you know, draft after draft, that rewriting, so that we have that objective perspective of reading something that's kind of new to us. Yeah, we know the idea, but when the other person goes off and writes the scene and gives it to the other, it's new to that person, right? So it's fresh eyes, it's an objective perspective, and it does allow for great quality control.
So you guys have been writing together for almost 20 years, I think I heard.
20 plus.
How did you guys first hook up?
We went to high school together. We grew up in Phoenix, Arizona many years ago and took different paths. I was a local news producer and then moved into reality TV. Rhett graduated college and came out here to screenwrite and was doing mostly children's stuff. And we, our first project, we were old friends and reconnected in LA. And I was producing a show called Big Brother 2, and Rhett got hooked on it. And we were watching one night, he came over and we were watching one night and we said, we should come up with a reality show. And that night we came up with the Joe Schmo Show, which was a combination scripted, you know, reality hybrid, where one guy came onto a show and didn't know that he was, you know, the only thing that was real. And that was the start of a beautiful partnership that's been ongoing for 20 years. We transitioned from reality into fully scripted with Zombieland, which we wrote on spec. And then you know, it's been off to the races, what, since 2005 we wrote Zombieland on Spec-Rhett? Is that still right?
Mm-hmm.
So we've been working in features and now, you know, a little more in TV, you know, producing wise, ever since.
I'm just curious, as you know, I mean, you started off producing, you know, you did some production, but, you know, as writers who are then, you know, now producing, what do you think, you know, you bring that, you know, maybe a non-writing producer doesn't bring? I mean, are you really strong on helping, you know, the writers on a project with their story, with their characters? What are your special talents, do you think, as producers?
I think it's kind of double-edged. I think on one edge, we can help better than your average executive because we're writers and we have ideas and we know how to solve problems within a script. But I think the other edge of the sword is we know what it's like to be a writer. So we know when to leave them alone and when to be supportive. And we don't give writers notes that we don't tell them they could take or leave. And I think they appreciate that. Like, we don't kind of exercise a heavy hand. We pick people we really trust and love, and we let them do their thing the way we wish sometimes we were allowed to do our thing. So I think the combination of those two things make us pretty good creative producers. I mean, at least in my mind. I don't know. You could ask the people who've worked with us.
So you mentioned, you know, notes, and that's a, you know, I think a lot of screenwriters, you know, especially as they're, you know, starting to work professionally, you're going to get notes from executives. How do you guys approach notes? You know, I think the common thing is to kind of look for the note behind the note, you know, to try to figure out what the root of the problem is. But, you know, when you guys are getting notes back from executives, how do you, you know, ingest and approach applying those to something?
We bang our heads against the wall most of the time when we first get the notes.
I think it's about picking great executives, right, who you know are going to give you good notes. I mean, it's like you don't bang your head as much or even at all if the notes are great. And so, you know, generally it's not as much what you're working on sometimes as who you're working with. And we try to work with people that we trust to have a good objective eye to identify problems and maybe help us solve them, or if not, at least identify them. And then we go about it. Like, you do have to get over the first half an hour of angst, you know, when you read them, but then you start to solve them in your head. I think the sooner you start to solve them, the sooner you start to realize, look, we're the same writers who wrote the first draft. We can throw out some of that stuff and create some new stuff. It'll be just as good, maybe even better. And we try.
And I do think the key is, even when we do get bad notes, and again, as Rhett said, hopefully we get more good notes than bad notes, and we have chosen to work with people where that is the case. But when we do get a bad note, our job as writers is take that bad note and to at least, you know, in our minds, move the script either laterally or forward, never backwards, right? Like, even in a bad note, it's like, how do we solve this? How do we make the executive happy, even when it's a bad note? And the key is always lateral or forward, never backwards. And sometimes that's more of a challenge than others.
That's interesting. I haven't heard that before. So take a giant step back. This is a question for each of you guys. When did you first, you know, get the bug and know you wanted to be a storyteller, Rhett? When was it for you?
Well, I loved Hardy Boy books when I was a kid. I started reading them in first grade, and by fifth grade, I was writing my own. I only wrote 13 pages, but 13 pages is a lot for a fifth grader. And what was so amusing when you go back and look at it is I was definitely adapting source material. Like, I was using the same tone and the same silly character, the same moments, same kinds of moments. Like, I was really picking up on stuff and kind of regurgitating it onto a page. I loved doing it. And I think from that moment, I knew I liked to tell stories. It wasn't really until college when I seriously entertained the idea of doing it professionally. But I think I kind of always been a little bit of a storyteller at heart.
Yeah. And me, I love storytelling, you know, from being a little boy growing up, and I was on a path to become a lawyer. I was a political science major in college and thought that that's what I was going to do, not because I wanted to do it, but because I just figured, what else am I going to do? And I did an internship in Washington, D.C. I was at UCLA, and they had an internship through D.C. And I was an intern at CBS Evening News for a political correspondent there, and fell in love with it, you know, his stories. We would go to lunch, and he was an old gruffy reporter. His name was Eric Engberg, and And he would tell just wonderful stories about presidents and you know, interactions with interesting people. And I thought, oh my God, this is what I want to do, is tell stories. And it wasn't a traditional Hollywood storytelling thing, but I graduated school and I immediately, you know, jumped into the news business. So that was kind of my first spark, is that this is what I want to do for a living. I didn't know that it would, you know, ultimately transform into what I'm currently doing, but I'm, you know, pleasantly, you know, surprised.
So. So what, you know, when you did kind of realize that, you know, maybe this is the direction you wanted to head in, what were like the practical steps for you? You're working in news, but you're getting, you know, you have an inkling that you might want to do this other thing. What were the steps that took you to the point where you're working, you're creating a reality show or a hybrid reality show, and then moving into scripted stuff?
Yeah. I mean, I think more than anything, I think most instructive would be kind of the philosophy rather than the steps, because the philosophy I think can translate over individuals into a larger thing, which is we just didn't play by the rules, right? Like there's no rule book. There's no, you know, people would tell you, no, you don't do this, right? It's like, no, you don't go from being a news producer to jumping into reality to then creating your own show. You've got to, you know, build your resume. That's just how it's done. No, that's not how it's done, right? We have this idea. We've got to go make it. So it was just the passion and the inability to accept no for an answer that I think ultimately was the greatest guide. And I think the most instructive thing we can tell people who are coming up in this business is there are no rules, right? There are no exact ways to write a screenplay. Every screenplay is different. Zombieland doesn't have a villain. You know, it's not there's no villain in Zombieland other than the zombies. You know, it's like, would that have survived, a classroom, you know, at, you know, getting your master's in screenwriting? Maybe not, you know, maybe that gets thrown out because it doesn't fall under the traditional, you know, banner of, you know, what screenplays look like in the three act structure and the whole thing. So my advice is always, you know, don't take no for an answer. Don't follow the rules. There are no rules. You know, forge your own path and have the passion, hit and hit and hit, and get up and get up and get up, because you know that you believe in yourself and you believe in your work, and it'll
fun. Man, I'm going to go attack my work with renewed vigor. This is awesome. It's inspirational.
Yeah, I'm going to go take a nap after.
So I guess one last question before we wrap up, getting an answer from each of you, but Rhett, you first. Is there something that you know now that you've learned across, you know, your career that you wish that college student who decided they want to be a writer, you wish that you knew right up front?
Well, there's an old Bob Seger line that I love, which is sort of the opposite of your question, which is, I wish I didn't know now what I didn't know then. And I think we are very, very cynical now. We are very numb a little bit. You know, we're less passionate probably than we used to be. And sometimes
I'm really now for sure going to go take a nap.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. I guess I feel like part of what you do need to tap into is that naive, ignorant optimism where you just go, look, the odds are against me and they're against anyone. And I'm going to go write what I want to write above all else. You know, what I really want to write doesn't have to be what I know. It doesn't have to be what the marketplace is talking about, or it certainly could be, but just write what I really want to write and commit to it with both halves of my brain and do as great a job as I can. And then keep doing that over and over until I break through. Like it's all cliches, right? There is no real path, but I do feel like had we, you know, applied some of our late game cynicism and defeatism to our early career, we wouldn't have made it. Like we needed, like nowadays we hear three no's, we're out. Like we're like, all right, that one's not going to be it. That back then, the Joe Schmo Show, we heard 22 or three no's, I think, before we finally got a yes. And so, and yet we kept at it because we were naively ignorant and willing to break rules and willing to be passionate and devil may care. So anyway, that's my answer.
I love it. And Paul, what about you? Is there something you learned over the past 20 plus years that you wish you knew back in the day?
Yeah. I'm going to go still with the emotional side of it and say, you know, don't get too low, you know, even keel, you know, it's like, the town's going to kick you in the balls, you know, over and over again. And the key is to not, you know, take those hits too hard and not, you know, get too high on the highs. And because, you know, a career, you know, and especially a Hollywood career can go through so many peaks and valleys, you know, it's, and the key is to level that out, to not, you know, get too low or too high. I you know, 'cause early on it was, you know, we would live and die with every, you know, every note, every, you know, every no, every yes, it was make or break it at every moment. And, you know, the key has been to try and level out over time. And yes, I wish I had leveled out then, because it's been such an easier, you know, I would have had more hair on my head and less gray hairs had I done so.
Well, I think that's a great note to end on. Rhett and Paul, congrats on the film. Thanks for taking the time to chat today.
Thank you, Phil. We really appreciate it.
Thanks again to Rhett and Paul for coming on the show. Spiderhead is streaming on Netflix right now. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.